Cambodia is one of the very, very poor countries. People living less than a dollar for a day. My family live in a small village in Bat Dambong province, and we don't have enough food to eat. So I had to go to the farm to help my parents digging the ground. So it's very, very difficult. One day I just walked past by the pastor's house back from school. So the pastor just gave me the invitation to join the Christmas program, and they tell me they have something for us. And then they say, also they have food. So I would love to come because of food. So when I came to the Christmas celebration, they were singing, they were worshiping, they were praying, they were talking about God and Jesus. At the end of service, they hand us a box and we open it. They have a jump rope. I also received a book and also some color pen. I saw this, the booklet called The Greater Gift. So I saw that was so interesting because they have a story in there and they have the color, they have a picture, and I read it over and over, and in that booklet would tell about God, Jesus Christ, and God will die on the cross for us. And I not just read it to myself, I also read it to my brother. He want me to read to him every evening. After I received the shoe box, I keep asking myself, where the box come from? Who packed a shoe box? Why they gave it to me? And I'm just a poor kid. So I went back to church. I asked the pastor where the shoe box come from and what is about Jesus Christ, what is God. And he said, if you want to know more, you can read the Bible. So he gave me the Bible to read. So I came to church about 2 or 3 months, come to church regular. I received a good thing too. They tell me to go to a youth camp. So when I went to youth camp, I was just so amazed. Only worshiping, they pray in the early morning. And I would like get goosebumps all the time when I would go to the big worship. So I was like crying. So then, at the end of the service, pastor was preaching about God, and he asking who want to give their life to God. I just go in front there and kneel my knee, and I say, God, I give my life to you. I give my life to you. Sometime when I at home, sitting there with my kids, with my husband, I was asking myself, if it would not be that shoebox, I would not be here. Just every single day, thank God for all His blessing.
Well, good evening. Don't forget, today is our Samaritan's Purse shoebox promotion. If you didn't get your box this morning, you can grab it as you leave the service tonight there at outside just this door in our welcome center area. So don't worry about getting it. Or if you did forgot about it this morning, you can get it tonight. All the events we got coming up, don't forget Pack a Pew Sunday will be October 2nd. That'll be in the morning service. That's actually when the choir, I said choir, will, the preparations have been made. You see behind me, I didn't reference this morning. Some things have been moved around. Practice has started, so preparations have been made for a great day. And so we just pray that God moves in that service. But I'll be honest with you, I pray God moves in this service. Amen. Don't forget about the ladies' Bible study. We talked about that this morning, and I got all these notes that everybody tells me to remember. So y'all help me, and my wife is not here to give me my hand signals that she normally gives me about these notes. Don't forget about the church-wide yard sale. Don't forget about the revival. We'll have more information on that. Our church will be leading service one night, and so we're going to ask all of our singers to come and sing. But I'll have more in a few weeks about that night, about that. Don't forget all about the bags of individually wrapped candy. needed for the Fall Festival. We have a tub out near the media center table that says candy for Fall Festival. That's not candy for you to go snack on, okay? And so I'm saying that to Warren, I'm saying that to Oscar, and I'm saying that to Hayden, I'm saying that to everybody. Don't go snacking, especially them Reese cups, okay? Those are my favorite. But no, we just need some more candy to give out during the game time, and just be in prayer for that coming up. Lift up Derek Thomas. The visitation for his sister, Miss Wendy, was today from 3 to 5. That funeral will be tomorrow at Ariel Baptist Church in Easley. I was thinking about this afternoon, everything going on, and we talked about valleys. I thought, man, I hammered it hard this morning, hammered at James. So I never really had a piece about, I kind of freaked out maybe the AV team back there about, I switched it up. So tonight we're going to talk about the I Am series. We're going to start that with the Bread of Life. So I've really been wanting to hit that kind of hard, and it's kind of more uplifting and kind of, I hate to do two sermons in a row on being in a valley, and sometimes that's called for, but I just felt God leading me to John chapter number 6 this afternoon, so that's where we're going to go. And so just be in prayer for the next couple weeks when we talk about the bread of life, the good shepherd, the door, light in the darkness, and all that, if we're going to cover that on Sunday night. And I want to challenge you to come on Wednesday night. We have a great time. Campus is full. Kids are running around. Youth are running around. Young folks are running around. And we have service in here as well. And this coming Wednesday night, I've been kind of sporadically just kind of preaching, and I did some minor prophets in the Old Testament. But this coming Wednesday night, we're actually starting a series on true biblical doctrine and true biblical worship. Because it's amazing. You talk to somebody out in the world how they don't have this right at all. They have it wrong. And so on Wednesday nights, we're going to kind of just do a deep study on true biblical doctrine that will lead into true biblical worship. Because a lot of times, you get somebody's opinion on something. I ain't going to start preaching now, but you get somebody's opinion on something, and there's an easy comeback to that. You know what it is? I think Brother Tim knows. It's you hand them your Bible, because they probably don't have theirs with them. Amen? And you hand them your Bible, and you say, chapter and verse. Show me your opinion in chapter and verse, and we'll do it. Matter of fact, it's probably not in there. And so I know it gets quiet when you start doing that, but we're going to talk about what the Bible says about true biblical doctrine and how it leads to true biblical worship. Be in prayer for all those on our prayer list. Also, if you have any unspoken requests, let it be known right now. All across. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. Lord, I thank you for being so good to us. Lord, I thank you for the service this morning. Lord, I thank you for that sweet family that trusted you to make this their church home. And Lord, I thank you for those who have joined in the past few weeks and the months. Lord, I pray that as we kind of closing out this year in September and looking forward to some things, Thanksgiving and Christmas and jockeying schedules and planning some things, Lord, I pray that we hit the ground running in 2023. That nothing's going to, that you, we pray that you do a mighty work here at Eastside, that we're better in 2023 than we were in 2022, and that we see you move time and time again. And Lord, I pray for those on our prayer list. Lord, I lift up Ella Grace and Jake and Tillman tonight. Lord, I pray for all those who've lost loved ones. I pray for Brother Derek and the passing of his sister. I pray, Lord, for those who just need a spiritual touch. And I pray, Lord, that Holy Spirit will rain on them specifically tonight. And as we talk about the bread of life, Lord, I pray that we all understand that we have a physical need, but we also have a spiritual need. And Lord, we know that we can eat bread and fill that physical need, but that bread of life, Lord, we know that you can fill that spiritual need. And Lord, I just pray for tonight. I pray, Lord, for the music, and Lord, I pray for the message. And Lord, again, I pray for the Holy Spirit to reign in this place, and that hearts and minds will be obedient to it. Lord, I thank you for all your many blessings. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for dying on the cross. In your precious heaven name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Good evening. Please stand with us as we sing and give glory to God. To God be the glory, great things he hath done.
Amen. Father, again, as we come to you tonight, we praise you for who you are, Lord. Thank you for dying on the cross so we can have life and have it eternal. I pray, Father, let the Holy Spirit just run these pews, Lord. Tender hearts, and Lord, wake them up. Let them see that they need you as their personal Savior. Lord, be with our tithes and offering. And all this we ask in our blessed name. Amen.
Sometimes we can't see how they could. Struggles that break our hearts in two, sometimes blind us to the truth. Our Father knows what's best for us. His ways are not just can't see him. Remember, you're never alone. God is too wise to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand, when you don't see his plan, when you can't trace his hand, trust his heart. He sees the master plan. He holds our future in his hand. So don't live as those who have no hope. All our hope is found in him. We see the present clearly. Oh, but he sees the first and the last. And like a tapestry, he's weaving you and me to someday be just like him. God is too wise to be mistaken. God is too good to be unkind. So when you don't understand,
amen. Thank you, Miss Erica. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to John chapter number 6. We're going to be looking at verses 35 through 40. One thing I did forget to mention is, ladies, don't forget the ladies' craft night coming up this coming Friday night. If you haven't signed up, you can sign up at the media center. Two robins were sitting in a tree. One of them said, "I'm really hungry." The other one looked at the other robin and said, you know what, me too. And the first one who said he was hungry said, let's fly down and find some lunch. They flew to the ground and found a nice plot of ground full of worms. They ate and ate and ate until they could eat no more. I'm so full, one of them said, I don't think I can fly back up to that tree. Me either, said the second one. So let's just lie here and rest in this warm sun. Okay, and so they agreed, and they plopped down, basking in the sun. No sooner had they fallen asleep than a big old fat tomcat snuck up on them and ate both them. As he sat there watching his face after that big old meal he just had, he thought to himself, man, I just love Baskin Robbins. Now you might say aw and groan and boo on that one, but I guarantee you're going to tell it around the water cooler at work tomorrow, okay? You're going to go back on Facebook and play it about 3 or 4 times tonight and write it down and share it at work tomorrow. But I think we can all say that we love food. I think we can say each one of us like a certain type of food. I'm sure there are some of us who would be honest and say they love breads, pasta, potatoes, probably everything that's not great for you. But tonight I want to talk about bread. Over the next few weeks, on Sunday nights, we're going to consider the I am statements that is recorded in the Gospel of John. And tonight we're going to examine what Jesus said as we see him as the bread of life. And I'll let you stay seated. But John chapter number 6, I'm going to start in verses 35 and go to verse 40. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believeth on me shall never thirst. But I said unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me, and him that cometh to me I will in him no wise cast out. For I came down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him that sent me. And this is the Father's will which hath sent me, that of all which he had given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. Verse 40. And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day. So tonight we're going to see Jesus as the bread of life. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. Lord, thank you for the service up to now, Lord. We understand that you are the bread of life. You give us everything that we need, and you give it to us right when we need it. Lord, I pray for these next few moments. Lord, I pray again, let your Holy Spirit will reign in this place. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for dying on the cross. In your precious heavenly name I pray, amen. The Bible records several statements by Jesus referring to himself as the I am. This was actually one word spoken in the Greek language called am I, which is simply I am. It was also translated it is I in some of the passages. John 4:26 says, Jesus saith unto her, I that speak unto them am he. John 6:20 says, but he saith unto them, it is I, be not afraid. John 8:24 says, I said therefore unto you that ye shall die in your sins. If ye believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. John 8:28 says, then said Jesus unto them, when ye have lifted up the Son of Man, then shall ye know that I am he, and that I do nothing of myself, but as the Father hath taught me, I speak these things. John 8:58 says, Jesus unto them, verily, verily, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. We get a good grasp, clear picture of the one who can say he is everything, and he just concludes it or starts it off by saying, hey, I am. What did the burning bush, Moses, had that encounter with the burning bush, and what do we find? Who is that? Moses, I am. I said a few weeks back, that is one of the most confirming messages that God has proclaimed and Jesus has proclaimed when he says, I am. And Jesus referred to himself in these passages by using the Old Testament name for God. Exodus 3:14, and God said to Moses, I am that I am. He clarified it even more. Moses, you may be in disbelief, but I am who I said I am. I am that I am. It actually kind of complements the phrase I am. You are who? I am that I am. You know what, folks? To make it real clear, it's really baffling to me. I had a conversation with somebody before church tonight in my office of why people don't get saved. It's the simplest and easiest gospel. Well, it's the only gospel. But you know what I mean? It's the simplest and only and easiest message. We have done nothing. He did all the work. And yet, I like the fact that we serve a Jesus and serve a God who it's not compartmentalized in a certain area. Well, you got to do this, you got to do that. Man, we serve a God, we serve a Jesus who he says, I am that I am. I am. What a confidence, what a confirmation from Jesus here. And John's gospel records the majority of the I am statements of Jesus. It's important to understand the context in which these statements were spoken. Jesus had come as the promised Messiah. He was God in human form, coming to provide redemption for fallen man. While many realized Jesus was special, not at all like any other man, most failed to see him as the Christ. Some failed today to see him as the Christ. These I am statements were made with a purpose to reveal himself as the Christ. He wanted them to see him as their Savior and Redeemer, come to provide salvation. And we understand, folks, that this is happening in chapter 6. We understand previously in chapter 6, you see the feeding of the 5,000. You see that he come and fed them with bread. You see that he come and fed them with fish. But now he's telling the disciples and those around him, hey, I'm coming to feed the spiritual side of life. And some still didn't recognize him. Listen, if somebody had come and I'll put it in this perspective. Let's say we ran out of hot dogs for a gathering we were doing, okay? And some man come in here proclaiming to be the Messiah, and we never heard about Jesus before. We never heard about a Messiah. We wanted one to come. We wanted one to come our way, the Redeemer. And all of a sudden, we ran out of hot dogs. And he sees a basket full of 5 hot dogs and 4 buns. And blesses it to where everybody can eat, everybody that comes eats, and then we have enough to send to-go boxes home. We're going to listen to that guy. We're going to want that guy to come back. But more times than not, Jesus would work these miracles, and they'd run him out of town because it affected their comfort. They didn't understand who Jesus was, and sometimes we're the... He was such a polarizing figure. Sometimes we're the ones who muck it up and make it too hard. And we can't understand he is the bread of life. We can't understand that we see his identity defined. Jesus revealed his true identity in verses 35 through 36. We discover a few things here. His affirmation. Look at verse 35. I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. Jesus begins this statement with the affirmation of who he is. I am. This is the first of several I am statements that he said, I'm the bread of life, the light of the world, the door, the good shepherd, the resurrection, the way, the truth, and the life, and the true vine. He wanted them to see him for who he was. He was much more than a man who worked wonders. He is the I am. And folks, he was the I am then, and he is the I am now. And surely this brought to mind when Moses stood by that burning bush when he heard again, I am that I am. Jesus would later proclaim his deity in John 8:58 that I read earlier. We must see the person of Jesus as he is. We can see him tonight as the great I am. Then we see his provision. Look at the end of verse 35. He that believeth on me shall never hunger and shall never thirst. The multitude was seeking physical bread that only would sustain them for a while. But Jesus offered the bread of life that once received, man would never hunger again. I grew up at a certain time where, I think probably earlier, but TV dinners was popular. And if we didn't get a home-cooked meal, my mom was an excellent cook, sometimes you have TV dinner night, you know. And I'd always get the turkey and dressing one. You know, I don't know why, everybody knows I don't like English peas. And, you know, they come in that little compartment there, so I kind of put that trash in the trash, okay? But then the TV dinner game got a little bigger, you know? Then you had the hungry man, you know, that came with like 2 or 3 pieces of chicken, you know, corn and mashed potatoes. And let me tell you something about the mashed potatoes and them TV dinners. Let me tell you something. You could spackle new tile in a bathroom with them mashed potatoes, okay? But you mix it with that corn, it wasn't that bad. Or get some crunchies from that chicken, man, it wasn't that bad. But hungry man, I think one of their early commercial ads was, "You'll never hunger again." Well, you know, that growing boy, I hungered again. Let me tell you something. But listen, folks, Jesus fills you up. You'll never hunger. You'll never thirst again. He offered the living water that would only satisfy the thirst of a hungry soul. Revelation 21:6 says, "And he said unto them, It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is at the thirst of the fountain of water of life freely." And who supplies that water, that fountain? Jesus does. Many today are like those who came to Jesus in that day. They're looking for things to satisfy, but can't seem to find what they're looking for. People come to church all the time and join up. We've been blessed by families joining our church. But folks, I want to be a church. You see what you can get, but you also see the possibilities that God can work here. Many look to the pleasures of the flesh and alcohol or a bottle of pills, but once those effects wear off, there's still a hunger and an emptiness of the soul. Jesus is the only one who can provide what we need, and his provision is eternal. One touch from the Lord, and by the way, folks, you'll never be the same again. You will be changed forever. Then we see his exaltation. Look at verse 36. "But I said unto you," look, you got to almost look at the end of verse 35 when he says, "Hey, you'll never hunger, you'll never thirst again." But then he kind of turns out, "But I said unto you that ye also have seen me and believe not." Man, words written in red. Jesus said out of his mouth. Can you imagine being there, hearing that? "You've seen what I've done. You've seen the miracles that I've done. You see the lives have been changed by believing on me, and still you believe not." Man, if that ain't talking to disciples and people around, and if that ain't talking to church folk, I don't know what is. Again, folks, people sit in the pew all day long. Come Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, and they'll be like, "You know, I don't want nothing to do with that. I believe not." You may not proclaim it, but you live in it. Jesus knows the desire of their hearts, and he knows the desire of your hearts. He knew their intentions. They were more than happy to receive the benefits he provided, but they were unwilling to submit to him as Lord and Master. Miss Erica, it takes a lot of work to get this going, didn't it? It takes a lot of practice. By the way, y'all should have stayed for a little bit of that touch of that choir practice Wednesday night. I heard it was blessing some souls here. Brother Randy, Brother Zach, them risers, them chairs sit on, they got some meat to them, don't they? Let me tell you something. If you need somebody to move some chairs in one time, get Brother Zach Wilkinson. He moved a row of 14 in one fell push right there. So if we need tables or chairs set up, we call him Zach if he ain't working. But it takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of work from those guys in the back, the wires going everywhere, putting that up, plugging this in, plugging that up. It takes a lot of work. It takes a lot of preparation to get to come and you see one service on a Sunday, much less three a week. You're like, "Three? You'll have three services a week?" Some of y'all don't even know that. We're open on business on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock. They were more than happy to receive the benefits. Well, people just want to come and worship. And I love that. I love when you can just go worship somewhere. And I hear that. Man, I just want to go worship somewhere. When people join this church, they're like, "We just felt like we can come worship." And I go, "You're halfway right. Here's what I want to hear." I say, "Preacher, I want to come join, and I want to get plugged in somewhere. I want to help where I'm needed. I want to see people saved. That's what I want to hear." We can all sit on the pew and here's what we try. Me and Erica and Mason and the praise team and those guys in the back, I tell you what we're going to do. We're just going to come worship one Sunday, and we're all going to sit on these first two rows, and y'all have at it. We'll see how it goes. Let's just wing it. Whoever wants to sing, sing. Whoever wants to turn this into karaoke, let's turn it into karaoke, okay? Whoever wants to just go ahead and start preaching, preach. But that's not how we do it, folks. We plan, we pray, plan, and prepare. And you guys receive the benefits. We do too, because we're doing this ministry that God's called us to do. But too many times you see God move and don't want to get plugged in, because I got to sacrifice. Got to sacrifice my time. Boy, listen, I know what time of year it is. By the way, the bad NFL games are at noon. The good ones are at 4:25. But the really good ones at 8:30 on NBC, so go ahead and. But their rebellion and unbelief would hinder their receiving his marvelous gift. Listen, folks, I don't want to. I know, Pastor, you have to say this. I don't like missing church. I like being with the assembly of God. I like being with the church folk. I like being with the family. And, man, more times than not, you just see people going, hey, you know, I got this going on. I'm going to have to miss tonight. Okay. Were you needed somewhere? Were you needed? Did you sign up for somewhere? Listen, folks, you sign up for the nursery or preschool and you don't show up, don't get let my know. I get emergencies happen, and we understand that. But you sign up and go, you know what, that man, this mattress feels so good tonight. I'm just gonna, or this couch, I'm going to stay home and watch this game. I don't feel like going tonight. We're going to have to call the SWAT team for that side of the building. They don't got no workers down there. And it ain't fair to the workers that already give time and time and time again to catch up on your slack. Right? You know, we got people that serve, and they're just kind of, they make the schedule and they serve. And if you don't show up, they got to serve. Why can't they come in here? You do. They didn't ask me to say that. But it's needed. We need more people in the nursery. We need more people in the preschool. How is it fair that, and I'll get to my point here, how is it fair that some people can just serve and serve and serve and miss service while we sit out here? It's because the folks out here that don't want to serve and get plugged in don't understand who the great I am is. They don't get it. They want to see God move. He told the disciples and some walking with him, hey, you see, but you don't believe. If you're here and you join and don't get plugged in, you're seeing but not believing. This fundamental truth has not changed and never will. No doubt all who have ever lived want to go to heaven when they die. All desire to receive the favor and grace of God in their lives, but all are not willing to receive Christ. He's the source of our salvation. There's no other way to be forgiven. There's no other way to get inherent eternal life. What we do with Jesus is the defining factor in our lives and our eternal destiny. He must be recognized and accepted as Lord if a man is to be saved. Then in verses 37 through 38, we see his authority. Jesus reveals a great truth about God's plan of salvation. Let's consider this moment for just a moment. First, we see his providence in the first part of verse 37. All that the Father giveth me shall come to me. Jesus speaks of those whom the Father has given him. He spoke of those who come unto him. We are to be saved and receive the bread of life. There must have been a drawing of the Lord. There must be a work of the Holy Spirit dealing with our hearts in conviction. We cannot leave God out of the salvation process. There are many today who are not saved, and yet they fully intend to get saved. They say, hey, I plan on getting saved before I die, just not right now. I have a lot of living to do. There's only one problem with that attitude. We can't get saved when we decide that we want to. The Lord must be dealing with us, drawing us and our heart toward Him. Many have had good intentions, but I fear that hell is filled with people with great intentions. And if you're unwilling to do business with God when He's dealing with your heart, what makes you think you'll be willing to do so when He isn't? Once again, we cannot leave God out of the salvation process. We must come as He leads. Then we see the assurance at the end of verse 37. And him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. Boy, I love that right there. When you talk to somebody who says you can lose your salvation, just point them to John chapter 6, in the verse 37 right there. Just point, well, God said if I know Him and I believe on Him, He ain't going to cast me out. Ha. Huh. You know, that's an ace card right there, you know. These sought fulfillment for a temporary need, those who asked Jesus that question, Jesus produced bread again. They could have been filled, but just as before, they would have hungered again. Jesus declared that all who come to him will be received and enjoy the benefits that he affords. Folks, he offers much more than physical bread to those who believe. What a promise right here from the child of God. All who come to him shall never be cast out. There will never come a day when we're asked to leave the presence of the God. There will never be a time when he fails to care for us. There will never be a circumstance that he is not able to provide for your need. John 10:28 says, "And I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand." Amen. Oh, we can lose our salvation? I don't think so. Let's go to John chapter 6. Then let's go to John chapter 10, verse 28. And Jesus said, "Nobody will pluck them out of my hand." The obedience in verse 38. Clearly, those present that day had not grasped the enormity of this encounter. Calvary was still in the distance, but Jesus already resigned himself to the cross. On a side note, some of us need to resign ourselves to a cross. We need to sacrifice something. We need to sacrifice for our faith, our family, and our fellowship. And that sacrifice, you know, I talked about tithing this morning during the welcome time, but, you know, I will never apologize for somebody serving in a church. I'll never apologize for that. I think the moment you have the doors open, people should be waiting out front like we're showing Titanic 2 here. You're like, "Pastor, that can't be a Titanic 2. Well, just go with me on that. I think there should be the people just waiting. Can't wait for the doors to open to get in here and hear about God. You're like, "Why ain't they?" You tell me. We have air conditioning. We have nice facilities. We have bathroom, indoor plumbing. We tell them the greatest message ever. But why are churches empty tonight? Why are churches dying tonight? You know why? Because people never received that bread of life, and they still hungered and thirsted for other things. And churches, instead of seeking God's face, went out and did their own thing. And think God is telling them to do this. Listen, folks, it's systematic. It's prayerfully planned out what we do here at Eastside. We're just not going to do some frivolous thing here which says, "Hey, we need to be doing this." You come to me with that, "Hey, Pastor, we need to be doing this." I'll pray about it. I will pray about it. But if God don't lead me to do it, don't get mad at me. Pastor, every fifth Sunday, or every fifth Tuesday, let's do this. Every fifth Tuesday, it needs to be Taco Tuesday in the FLC. That sounds great. But if the Lord don't lead me to say, "Hey, every fifth Tuesday is Taco Tuesday," we're not going to do it. We need to understand, folks, it's never, never about us. We need to understand that salvation is the most precious gift that one could receive, and I'm truly thankful that I've been saved, but often we forget just what our Savior endured to fulfill this plan. And I say that right there because I think if you understand the sacrifice Jesus paid, and people let that sink in a minute, the place will be packed. Somebody died for you, died for your sins, so you wouldn't have to go to hell. All you have to do is accept him as your Lord and Savior and turn from your wicked ways. I'm in. But the reason some people don't is because some people that sit in here and take advantage and soak it up like a sponge never squeeze it out in the world. They don't share it. They keep it secret. Why would you not want to tell people who the great I am is? One of the reasons is because they don't know him. Can't share what you don't know. Can't share what you don't have. I know that's tough, but listen, folks. We live in a world today where this message gets watered down every Sunday. every Sunday morning, every Sunday night. People are changing the way they're doing things, and it has ruined the name of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we see, you water down the message, you get people in. You water it down. But we also see churches that are really good in our association who don't water it down. And God's blessing them. You keep to the word and he'll bless it. But it takes a whole seamless transitionless service as well. That's where the call to worship, that's where the music and the message all go hand in hand. We see that he was a holy, sinless Son of God. He knew no sin. He who never once committed sin or had to seek forgiveness took it upon ourselves, bear our sin. He could have called again more than 12 legions of angels and escaped the cross, but he submitted to that awful death so that we might be saved. His reliability defended. In verses 39 through 40, Jesus reveals the matchless power that is associated with our salvation. First, we can consider our preservation. Verse 39, once again, Jesus is speaking of the will of the Father. He had come to offer himself as a sacrifice, fulfilling God's plan, and all who come to him in salvation will be kept by his power. Of all the Father has given him, he should lose nothing. Not a single soul has come to Christ as lost. No doubt those who follow Jesus may have wondered about their security in him as he died upon the cross, but death was not the end of our Lord. He rose from the grave, victorious over sin, having completely secured salvation for all who come unto him. And we can take comfort in that tonight. In fact, we can greatly rejoice. All who are saved are kept by the power of God. We are kept, if we're saved, by the great I am. I am the one who's got you forever. I'm the one that nobody can pluck you out of my hand. I'm the one that's going to release you to heaven when you leave this earth. I'm the one that's going to hold you when times are tough. I am the one that's always going to hold you and stand with you when things are bleak. There aren't enough demons in hell to remove us from the grace and power of Jesus Christ. Every soul that has ever received Christ will be found worshiping him in heaven. Then in verse 40, we see our salvation. Long before Jesus ever walked on this earth in the form of man, sin had entered into the hearts of men. That sin caused separation between God and man. Because of that sin, all who ever lived stood condemned in that sin. God demanded that we be righteous. Why? Because he's righteous. It's impossible within ourselves. There had to be a sacrifice to atone for that sin in order for restoration to be made. Jesus became that sacrifice. Through him, man now be restored unto God. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. I'm glad that I no longer stand condemned, but I have received his righteousness. The key to this verse is everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him. There's some tonight, folks, that see but don't believe. You got to see and believe. We must see our need before a holy God and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior. There were many in Jesus' day who knew who he was, but they never believed on him. Many today know who Jesus is, but they never come to him in salvation. There must be more than head knowledge. We must know Christ in a personal way. There's got to be that heart knowledge. Then we see our resurrection. Twice in these verses, Jesus spoke of those who will be raised up on that last day. He's speaking of the coming resurrection. Many who believed in the Lord have gone by the way of the grave. But just as it was for our Lord, death is not the end for the child of the King. We too have the hope of being raised again when Jesus steps out and calls for his bride. Titus 2:13 says, looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God, our Savior, Jesus Christ. I'm sure all of us today or this afternoon might have gone to the store, a restaurant, or a pantry in our kitchen and bought bread or got bread or a cracker or something like that. You know, unless the weatherman calls for an inch of snow, you ain't going to find good luck finding a loaf of bread here. We've all had the luxury of having bread to eat. I'm sure some of us have some kind of bread today with lunch or supper in a few moments. In Jesus' time, bread was a commodity. It was also a necessity. It was necessary for survival. Bread was the only thing some had to eat. We need to treat Jesus, the bread of life, as a need for survival. We need him to survive eternally. We need him now. Listen, folks, this world is getting bleaker and bleaker by the day. It's getting worse and worse by the day. It's getting, we as a society mock God. We do. We as a society mock the very holiness and righteousness and presence of God. And for our survival, we need to keep close to the one who calls himself the I Am. And I trust you've considered tonight the gracious benefit we have available through the great sacrifice of Jesus. He died on our behalf. He truly is the bread of life. Those who come to him will never hunger, and those who believe on him will never thirst. He provides satisfaction and assurance for the hungry and thirsty soul. He promised eternal life for all who come to him by faith. His provision satisfied our need today and sustains our lives for all eternity. Have you received that bread of life? We used to go see Chrissy's grandmother in North Carolina. She lived in Wilkesboro, North Carolina. And to get there, you take three turns. When you get on 85, take exit 16 in North Carolina, get on 321, then take Highway 18 to get there. It takes about 3.5 hours to get there. We were driving one weekend to go up there, and we had three children. Ava and Ivy were not born yet. And this was when she was still living. She's no longer with us. And on 85 in that little corridor in Spartanburg, between Spartanburg and Gaffney, where that pig chute always is. And I don't know why that thing can't get on schedule. I don't know why that thing's always under construction, but it was even then that back then. We get in that little pig chute area where it gets two lanes, and I remember, I think it was Roman. He saw that big tractor trailer truck. It had them white feathers blowing out of it. And we followed that truck all the way to Wilkesboro. You know why? Because one of the main industries in Wilkesboro. I mean, we hit it in Spartanburg on 85 and followed that, or that thing followed us all the way to Wilkesboro, North Carolina. You know why? Because the Tyson Chicken Plant is located in one of them is Wilkesboro, North Carolina. But I remember seeing it, and Roman goes, "Daddy, what is that?" I said, "That's a chicken truck, Roman." He's like, "What are they taking them chickens to?" You know, do I want to have this conversation on 85 right now? I'm just trying not to die, okay? And he said, "Well," I said, "son, that's chicken that goes to the restaurants that we eat." And he's like, "Man, I could eat a whole lot off that truck right there." You know what? We can eat a whole lot off Jesus Christ. Matter of fact, that's a buffet that never runs dry. Matter of fact, he says, you will never hunger, you will never thirst again. And that means spiritually. Yeah, physically we're gonna hunger and we're going to thirst, but our soul will never hunger or thirst after we give our heart and life to him. So let me ask you, are you trusting solely in him through repentance and faith for salvation? Do you trust in him for salvation? If not, I encourage you to come tonight and find that fulfillment that only he can bring, that your soul desires. Fill your heart with the great I Am. Would you please stand, bow your head, and close your eyes? And by looking around, over the next few weeks on Sunday night, we're going to talk about the great I Am and what he says he is. And he's the one who says that. You know, you look at other gods who talk about and read what they wrote or what other people wrote. They all required something. They required a gift. They required for you to do something, you to put in the work, you to do to get the eternal sacrifice, the eternal blessing. But with our Lord, our God, our one true and only way, he did all the work. That's why he's a loving God. That's why he can say, I am. There's nothing else you can finish after that. We serve a God who says, I am, dot, dot, dot. We serve a God who says, I am, period. You can add anything after that. I am your everything. I am your living water. I am your bread of life that we're going to talk about over the next few weeks. I am everything that you need. Physically, emotionally, relationally, spiritually, I am. Do you trust him tonight? Do you trust the great I am? You can with your heart and life. Why are you putting it off? Why are you waiting another Sunday, another week? Why not bring that peace that only he can bring? Why keep running? Why keep denying him? You come right now as the Holy Spirit leads.